Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents VC, An American History, by Tom Nicholas, narrated by Bob Souer. Publisher's Note: This audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type VC into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page, then, under the Supplemental Contents section, please enter the access code TREND and then click the Unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. Introduction: The Significance of History. Venture capital, VC, is largely an American invention. It is a hits business where exceptional payoffs from a few investments in a large portfolio of startup companies compensate for the vast majority that yield mediocre returns or simply fail. This long-tail distribution of payoffs has been embraced with more impact in the United States than anywhere else in the world. Today, Silicon Valley stands as the world's most important center of VC-based entrepreneurship, despite challenges to its leadership position. This book explains how America's advantage in VC finance was first created, why it has been so sustainable, and what history has to say about its future. The origins of the venture capital industry in America are conventionally traced back to the founding of the Boston-based American Research and Development Corporation, ARD, in 1946. ARD was among the first investment firms to attempt to systematize long-tail investing in startups in a way that is analogous to the modern venture capital industry. Yet, many of the characteristics defining modern venture finance can be clearly seen in much earlier historical contexts, such as New England whaling ventures and the early financing of industrialization provided by elites. History shows how some key financial institutions and precedents were developed early on and offers valuable perspective on the industry's future. It also helps to reveal why venture capital is so prominently American. Venture capital is concerned with the provision of finance to startup companies, and it is heavily oriented toward the high-tech sector, where capital efficiency is at its highest and the potential upside is greatest. Modern VC involves intermediation by general partners in VC firms who channel risk capital into entrepreneurial ventures on behalf of limited partners, typically pension funds, university endowments, and insurance companies, which characteristically do not act as direct investors in startups. For their intermediation, VC firms receive remuneration in the forms of annual management fees, typically 2% of the capital committed by limited partners, and carried interest as a share of the profits generated by an investment fund, typically 20%. VC funds tend to last about 7 to 10 years, and the firms behind them often manage multiple funds simultaneously. It is well known that the VC model of financing is characterized by a distinct approach to payoffs. Venture capital returns do not follow a normal bell-shaped distribution like stock market returns, but rather tend to be highly skewed. A few exceptional investments in the long right-sided tail, such as Genentech or Google, generate the bulk of the aggregate return. This book describes the attraction of these low-probability but high-payoff outcomes as the allure of the long tail, and defines the pursuit of them as distinct, though not mutually exclusive from, the periodic behavior associated with manias and speculative bubbles, and the persistent behavior associated with long-shot betting events, such as lotteries, where expected value can be negative. In the venture capital context, long-tail investing denotes a systematic approach to the deployment of risk capital into entrepreneurial ventures by intermediaries who attempt to use their domain expertise to generate large returns. In a world of perfect information and efficient markets, economic theory suggests intermediaries should be absent. The fact that venture capitalists do exist is arguably because they are able to maintain informational advantages in the selection and governance of startup investments. Another interpretation is that they function merely as capital conduits and organizers, but do not particularly add value in terms of startup outcomes. Long-tail returns have always been difficult to generate, and the VC industry has sometimes been chaotic and subject to the destructive ebbs and flows of investment cycles. History shows, however, that the social benefits of venture capital have been immense. By facilitating the financing of radical new technologies, U.S. venture capitalists have supported a large range of high-tech firms whose products, from semiconductors to recombinant insulin, telecommunications inventions, and search engines, have revolutionized the way we work, live, and produce. While technological change can often disrupt labor markets and increase wage inequality, in the long run, innovation is essential to productivity gains and economic growth. The venture capital industry has been a powerful driver of innovation, helping to sustain economic development and U.S. competitiveness. Given the importance of the United States to the history of venture capital, this book adopts a U.S.-centric focus. Yet the book's analysis could begin with a context more deeply historical and global. Early on, the need to divide financial payoffs from joint pursuits led mankind to establish rules and norms akin to those used in the modern venture capital industry. Some of the classical civilizations of the Mediterranean were characterized by stable, highly profitable, and well-developed systems of commercial enterprise. While markets were frequently rudimentary in both scale and scope, transactions could extend beyond familial ties to arm's-length exchanges between investors and traveling merchants. Medieval Venice was strikingly modern in terms of its contracting traditions, and it could be argued that the Venetians acted very much like venture capitalists in their operation of risky trading voyages. A milieu of institutions and cultural norms facilitated the expansion of enterprise through commercial ventures. It was in the United States, however, that structure and contracting became embedded into capitalism through the provision of finance for entrepreneurship. As a way of organizing the narrative, this book identifies four main stages in the history of venture capital from the 19th century up to the early 21st century. These chronological stages are not always cleanly distinct from one another, and the allure of long-tail investing is the theme that runs through them all. The stages reflect the development of some of the most important financial institutions and practices which were then carried forward. Over time, the VC function of providing capital to startups evolved from being conducted by collections of wealthy individuals to being the work of specialized firms. Enabled by the challenging cultural and regulatory environment in the United States, the VC industry expanded to large scale and became increasingly impactful in the sphere of entrepreneurial finance. The first stage saw early investors deploying risk capital into high-risk and potentially high-reward activities in ways that established historic precedents for VC-style investing. Chapter 1 focuses on risk capital deployment in the New England whaling industry, which has especially striking parallels with modern VC in terms of organization, payoffs, and more. Whaling was one of the largest and most important industries in America during the early 19th century. In it, New England whaling agents looked a lot like modern venture capitalists. There were wealthy individuals able to supply finance, and there were captains and crew willing to initiate and manage voyages, and whaling agents intermediated between the two groups in much the same way that today's venture capitalists intermediate between entities like pension funds that supply risk capital and entrepreneurs capable of applying that capital to profit-making opportunities. Like venture capitalists, whaling agents charged fees and received a share of the profits in return for intermediation. They engaged in repeat business with the best captains. They sometimes syndicated to spread risk, and the most capable of them, along with the most capable captains, enjoyed returns that were persistent over time. Flexible partnership structures worked because of strong compensation incentives, and the reasoning behind profit splits on whaling voyages still persists today in the conventions regarding how equity should be allocated to the various roles in entrepreneurial startups. The allure of a successful multi-year whaling voyage was strong, but it carried significant downside risk. Chapter 1 provides extensive data on profits and incentives from this exceptional early industry to establish the strength of the correspondence between whaling ventures and modern VC. Chapter 2 provides more insight into how risk capital was deployed in this first stage in the history of venture capital, focusing on the financing of leading-edge cotton textiles innovation in Lowell, Massachusetts, essentially the first Silicon Valley-type cluster in America. As New England financing elites redirected capital from merchant trading to industrial production, their need to access high-tech know-how compelled them to develop new heuristics to guide their contracting. Examining the structure of contracting, it is clear that trade-offs between cash flow and control rights were being made in ways similar to the contracting strategies venture capitalists use today as they interact with entrepreneurs. The intersection of entrepreneurship, technology, and finance was powerful. In 1820, Lowell had a population of only 200 citizens. There was not much in that location but land and fast-moving water and the Merrimack River as a source of power. By 1836, however, Lowell's population had exploded to 17,633, and by 1845 it had topped 30,000. The financing of new innovation hotspots further west gave rise to additional Silicon Valley-style clusters. Most notably, Cleveland and Pittsburgh became high-tech hubs between 1870 and 1914 in such areas as electric lighting, chemicals, oil, and steel. The industrialist and politician Andrew Mellon became a pivotal venture capitalist as he devised ways to finance local enterprise in this region, relying on syndicated lending, governance, and equity participation. Extending the analysis of the first stage in venture capital's history, Chapter 3 shows how the informal and formal markets for VC-style finance evolved over time in both the East and West Coast regions. During the late 19th and early 20th centuries, the kinds of affluent individuals who would today be called angel or super angel investors, and more formal, albeit small-scale, private capital entities, provided finance for new ventures. Investors captured upside in returns using convertible securities transferable into common stock later in the firm's life cycle, while simultaneously mitigating downside risk due to the seniority of these securities. Financing was often tied to board representation, managerial assistance, and other governance mechanisms. Looking at this first stage in the history of VC, the direct lineage from some early entities based on family wealth to various modern VC firms can also be traced. For example, Lawrence Rockefeller, the grandchild of the oil baron John D. Rockefeller, was a prolific venture capitalist. Venrock Associates, founded in 1969, is an extension of his investing activities. Another well-known venture firm today, Bessemer Venture Partners, was founded in 1981 as a spin-off from a family office created by Henry Phipps, who had partnered with the famous steel magnate Andrew Carnegie. In 1946, John H. Whitney, the son of a wealthy industrialist, founded J. H. Whitney & Company, which also endures to this day. During the 1940s and 1950s, Whitney recognized the challenges associated with constructing a portfolio of early-stage investments to generate long-tail returns, as opposed to building a portfolio of more mature firms. This helps to explain why the firm shifted away from early-stage investing over time and became increasingly oriented toward later-stage private equity. The second stage in the history of venture capital roughly spans the 1940s to the 1960s. It involved the implementation by specialized firms of the VC model focusing on right-skewed returns and the gradual shift toward adoption of the limited partnership structure. Chapter 4 covers the origins, organizational structure, strategy, and performance of the pivotal entity, ARD, founded in Boston after the Second World War by local elites who felt a sense of civic duty to fund enterprise and regional growth in New England. From a modern-day perspective, ARD was unusual in that it was organized as a closed-end fund and did not employ the limited partnership structure that is the leading organizational form used in the venture capital industry today. Its highly successful 1957 investment in the computer startup Digital Equipment Corporation illustrated that the venture capital hits model could work. ARD was able to build a portfolio of investments in which the return from one big hit could offset many middling or loss-making investments. Furthermore, ARD was founded at a time when America was largely devoid of institutions to provide risk capital to startups, a problem that had prevailed since the Great Depression. Government efforts to close the funding gap culminated in the 1958 Small Business Investment Company program, which created private sector investment companies to provide capital to small businesses. Given the sense that the gap was an instance of market failure, debate centered on the extent to which the government should intervene in the allocation of venture capital. Ard powerfully illustrated the potential effectiveness of a market-based approach to the intermediation of risk capital. During this second stage, the venture capital industry came to be dominated by limited partnerships, an organizational form with a long history. Chapter 5 shows that this structure made sense because it allowed venture capitalists to exploit tax advantages and avoid laws mandating the public disclosure of sensitive information regarding compensation and fund-level performance returns. It is no accident that the first limited partnerships emerged during the tax shelter era from the mid-1950s to the mid-1970s. The choice of organizational form, however, also involved disadvantages. The limited partnership with a finite lifetime, typically less than a decade, worked against a more long-term investment focus. The first venture capital limited partnership in Silicon Valley, Draper, Gaither & Anderson, founded in 1959 in Palo Alto, California, generated poor returns, underscoring the difficulty of realizing payoffs from a portfolio of early-stage investments within the timeline of a limited partnership. Other firms profiled in the chapter: East Coast-based Greylock Partners, founded in 1965 by William Elfers after a long career at Ard, and Venrock Associates, did much better, however, providing impetus to expansion in the industry. Crucially, this stage also saw government policy play a key role with large industry-wide effects. In the late 1970s, the clarification of rules relating to the Employee Retirement Income Security Act of 1974 created a supply-side boost to venture capital and the limited partnership model because it gave pension funds much more leeway to invest in risky asset classes. Venture capitalists had helped to shape this aspect of the market framework through the National Venture Capital Association, founded in 1973, which lobbied heavily for legislative change. That trade group also expended considerable effort lobbying for the changes to capital gains tax policy that venture capitalists at the time considered necessary for the industry to flourish. The third stage in the history of venture capital in America played out from the late 1960s through the 1980s, as the long-tail model of VC investing was repeatedly verified and the wider ecosystem to support early-stage investing developed. Chapter 6 explores, against the backdrop of the history of startup finance in Silicon Valley, how various factors came together, including human capital development facilitated by local educational institutions, government investment in military-based technologies, focal high-tech firms, and high-skilled immigrants. The combination of these meant that, by the mid-20th century, the area that became known as Silicon Valley was well poised to displace the East Coast as a center of entrepreneurship and high-tech innovation. Three key figures in the history of venture capital, Arthur Rock, co-founder of Davis & Rock in 1961, Tom Perkins, co-founder of Kleiner Perkins in 1972, and Don Valentine, founder of Sequoia Capital in 1972, responded to and helped compound that regional advantage. All were born and educated on the East Coast, but migrated to the opportunity-rich West Coast. Rock, Perkins, and Valentine were responsible for some of the most important investments of the 20th century in companies such as Intel, Genentech, and Cisco Systems. Continually proving the VC model based on hits and long-tail investments, they generated staggering fund-level returns. They also personified the three oft-cited investment styles in the VC industry, since Rock tended to identify opportunities based on investing in people, Perkins emphasized investments in technology, and Valentine stressed the idea of investing in markets. Chapter 7 examines a crucial decade in the third stage in the history of venture capital, the 1980s. For the first time, the industry experienced a pronounced high-tech boom and bust cycle from about the time of Apple Computer's 1980 initial public offering, IPO, through 1984. The industry grew in scale as a result of both the supply-side effects of the government policy changes discussed in Chapter 5 and the repeated verification of the VC hits model covered in Chapter 6. Scale created challenges associated with managing larger funds, and the decade was associated with more general industry structure changes. The best venture capital firms were distinguished by their performance records, giving rise to the notion of a top-tier venture firm. The industry sorted itself into different varieties of venture capital formation, and segments formed according to firm size, geographic focus, and sector, that is, private venture capital, corporate venture capital, or government initiative. Mezzanine finance, specialized IPO intermediation, and venture debt all became instrumental to the industry's evolution. Leadership transitions in the marquee firms gave rise to a new generation of exceptional investors. Women's representation in venture capital became a discussion point, flagging issues that have yet to be resolved. The fourth stage in the history of venture capital in America is defined by the widespread implementation of its investing model, culminating in the late 1990s stock market run-up and subsequent crash. Chapter 8 covers the 1990s and early 2000s as the most volatile period in U.S. venture capital history. The high-tech revolution of the early 1990s witnessed a new era of hardware, software, and telecommunications innovations, mostly in response to the commercialization of the Internet. Importantly, this period witnessed a flurry of investments in software and online services, setting precedents for a trend in VC investing that continues to the present. Online retailing became a particularly hot area of investment because consumer buying was expected to shift rapidly from brick-and-mortar stores to online sellers. As the IPO market became more active, opportunities for liquidity increased and expected payoffs rose steeply. Capital commitments in the venture capital industry peaked in 2000 at over $100 billion. In the immediate aftermath of the high-tech, dot-com, and telecommunications crash in 2001 to 2002, when trillions of dollars of stock market value were wiped out, attention focused on the destructive side of the venture industry and how its dynamics had created unproductive incentives. Yet, although venture capitalists were criticized for performance defects and a legitimacy crisis ensued, from today's vantage point, this era looks considerably more productive than it did at the time. In retrospect, it can be seen as one of the most profoundly important epochs in the history of American business. Given the impossibility of gaining useful historical perspective on events that have only recently unfolded, no attempt has been made to push the main analysis of this book beyond the early 2000s. A concluding epilogue does, however, attempt to look forward by reflecting on points in history in light of the changed context and debates of recent years. In doing so, it builds on five main themes that are recurrent across the chapters. First, history shows that exceptional VC-style payoffs have been sporadic and infrequent, concentrated in specific firms and time periods. Indeed, the industry as a whole has reflected more of a cultural habituation to risk and a behavioral bias toward long-tail investing than an evolution toward any more systematic realization of outsized returns. Second, if one asks how exactly VCs do what they do, it is not clear that the answer today is much different from half a century ago. The dominant form of organization is still the limited partnership with an ephemeral fund life, even though this places constraints on the timescale of investment returns. Although there have been some organizational structure and strategy innovations, these have been paradoxically rare in an industry that finances radical change. Third, while it is often argued that Silicon Valley's special advantages can be challenged by competitive emulation, within America or globally, this misses the fact that the region's development as a center of VC-fueled entrepreneurship has been deeply historically contingent. It is largely because the U.S. venture capital industry emerged in a specific cultural and regulatory context that replication efforts elsewhere have been largely unsuccessful. At the same time, the threat remains real as China and other countries seek their own pathways. Fourth, and relatedly, it is important to note that the often ignored fact that the venture capital industry became institutionalized partly as a consequence of government policy. Lawmakers shaped the enabling environment, kick-starting regional growth in what would become Silicon Valley, by crafting policies that allowed institutional investors to increase their risk tolerance in making investment choices, changed the taxation of investment gains, and promoted more high-skilled immigration. In many ways, the U.S. government acted as America's VC writ large by funding the basic university research that would break open the development pathways to entrepreneurial businesses. Clearly, the future of the VC industry in the United States will depend on maintaining key aspects of that amenable, enabling environment. Fifth, from a cultural standpoint, it is inescapable that the history of VC examined in this book centers on the activities and achievements of white males. This mirrors the composition of the American business and financial elite more generally. Reversing the venture capital industry's poor record on diversity will be vital to its future in terms of talent management, competitiveness, performance returns, and how the industry is publicly perceived. As a final note, while the main objective of this book is to establish the major contours of venture capital's history in the United States from its early beginnings up to the recent past, the book is written with a broader context in mind. Through the lens of the history of the venture capital industry, the essence of American-style free markets is revealed, including the forcefulness of incessant competition in startup finance and the incentives that condition the inexorable pursuit of capital gain. The venture capital industry emerged in a cultural context where entrepreneurial risk, wealth accumulation, and financial payoffs were embraced in ways that have not been as palatable in other countries. The allure of the long tail can be seen as a manifestation of much deeper economic and cultural uniqueness, highlighting how capitalism in general has evolved and been embraced in the United States. 1. Whaling ventures. The investment models behind whaling expeditions and venture capital funds can be thought of as interchangeable. The payoff distributions in the two industries are strikingly similar. Whaling agents intermediated between the wealthy individuals who supplied funds and the captains and crew who undertook voyages, just as VCs intermediate between limited partners and entrepreneurial teams in portfolio companies. The rise of American inventiveness in whaling reflected a distinct culture of entrepreneurial exceptionalism, risk capital deployment, and the pursuit of outsized returns. Rates of return on capital could be high in whaling, but so was the downside risk associated with this unpredictable and hazardous industry. In the United States, whaling was one of the earliest kinds of enterprise to grapple with the complexities of risk capital intermediation, organizational form, ownership structure, incentives, team building, and principal-agent trade-offs. The whaling business represents an important starting point for exploring the origins of American venture financing. Whaling first became a commercial industry in the 16th century as Icelandic and Biscayan whalers operated around 60 vessels in this business annually. The Dutch became dominant later and until about the 1770s, operating in the area east of Greenland before competitive advantage shifted to Britain. Parliamentary bounties spurred merchants to speculate in the trade as annual voyages proliferated from coastal ports to the Arctic in search of bowhead whales. By the 19th century, however, the United States had become the clear and unambiguous industry leader. By around 1850, almost 75% of the 900 whaling ships worldwide were American registered. New England was the center of U.S. whaling. Nantucket initially rose to be the most prominent location. In 1768, it possessed 125 whaling ships, and then New Bedford ascended, once larger ships struggled to navigate Nantucket's sandbar. In their extensive study of the industry, Lance Davis, Robert Gallman, and Karen Gleiter suggested that the American advantage came from a mix of factors including entrepreneurship and management via the human capital of agents, captains, and crews, technological innovations such as vessel design, and the powerful lay system of incentive payments, which meant that whalemen essentially held equity in voyages. Despite these incentives, it was difficult to predict the likelihood of success. Consider the famous voyage of the Essex, which inspired Herman Melville's 1851 fictional masterpiece Moby Dick. With a track record of success and a reputation as a lucky ship, the Essex set sail from Nantucket Island in Massachusetts in August 1819 for the Pacific Ocean on what was expected to be a lucrative whale hunting venture. In November 1820, on an otherwise uneventful day, an 85-foot sperm whale rammed the ship's port side when the crew targeted a whale pod. The 238-ton whale ship capsized and sank, leaving the crew members scrambling into three whale boats with provisions collected from the wreckage. In December 1820, the crew arrived at a deserted island. Some stayed while others headed for the coast of South America, almost 3,000 miles away. Those who survived the ravages of the ocean were rescued 2 months later by whale hunting ships operating off the coast of Chile. At first glance, it might be difficult to see that 19th-century whaling had any commonalities with modern-day venture capital. The decisions made by entrepreneurs in portfolio companies do not carry the mortal risks faced by the captain and crew of the Essex. Furthermore, while entrepreneurs can generate returns from new technologies using mechanisms like patents, the major challenge faced by the agent, captain, and crew associated with any whaling venture was to find new whale populations over which they held no property rights. A detailed examination of the respective industries, however, shows how close the parallels are, especially regarding the distribution of payoffs. The vast majority of VC-backed companies fail, making for a pronounced long tail. The hits are expected to offset the investments that yield losses and mediocre returns. The recent performance of a top-tier venture capital firm shows that 52% of the gross return on its portfolio was generated by startups that accounted for just 6% of the total cost of the investment portfolio. Of the individual investment decisions made by this VC firm, 62% were loss-making, while 5% generated multiples of more than 10 on the original investments. This distribution of returns reflects the fact that hit VC investments, just like successful whaling expeditions, are difficult to identify ex ante. To illustrate the striking parallels between returns in modern VC and in whaling, I use the data on whaling voyages from Davis, Gallman, and Gleiter to describe the industry. They constructed their data from a variety of sources, including the voyages listed in Alexander Starbuck's magisterial 1878 History of the American Whale Fishery and the dataset of 4,127 New Bedford whaling voyages from 1783 to 1906, compiled by Joseph Diaz, who was likely himself a New Bedford whaling captain. With data on variables such as which agent organized the voyage, the length of time the ship was at sea, the cost of outfitting and provisioning, and the amount of sperm and whale oil and whalebone the ship brought back to port, Davis, Gallman, and Gleiter calculate the profitability of individual voyages. They interpret the profit of a voyage as representing a mix of payments for bearing uninsurable risks, rents on knowledge and managerial skill, disequilibrium profits, for example, profits arising out of a sudden increase in demand, and returns to innovation. Although these estimates are prone to measurement error because of the limitations associated with historical data, they provide remarkable insights into the nature of whaling voyage returns. Figure 1.1 in the online resources plots the profitability of voyages in the Davis, Gallman, and Gleiter dataset against the net internal rate of return, IRR, realized by all funds in the VC industry across vintage years 1981 to 2006, tracked by Prequin, one of the major vendors of venture capital data. It is important to recognize that these are not like-for-like comparisons. The time periods, contexts, units of analysis, and metrics are all obviously different. Nevertheless, the distributions are extraordinarily similar in shape. Note in Figure 1.1 that 34.5% of whaling voyages ended up generating a return of zero or below, and that 32% of VC funds generated a zero or negative net IRR. Although 65.5% of whaling voyages were profitable, very few were exceptionally so, with just 1.7% of them achieving profit rates in excess of 100%. Similarly, only 2.9% of VC funds had net IRRs in excess of 100%. Similarity in the distribution shows up again in Figure 1.2 of the online resources, which focuses on the top 29 whaling firms, a subset distinguished by Davis, Gallman, and Gleiter because these agents had organized at least 40 voyages, and the top 29 VC firms in Prequin. The returns for whaling voyages reflect Starbuck's contemporary observation that, while some vessels on their voyages have made but poor returns, even bringing at times damaging loss to their owners, others have done extraordinarily well and brought in fortunes to those investing in them. When Peter Thiel writes of the heavily skewed distribution associated with modern VC that a small handful of companies radically outperform all others, he might just as easily be describing the whaling industry two centuries earlier. Success and failure in whaling. The distribution of returns in whaling was skewed for a variety of reasons. During the early years of the American whaling industry, proximate coastal waters could be exploited at low risk. But when local whale stocks were depleted and whales began to be pursued further into the Atlantic, risk increased substantially. By the 1820s, the risks increased yet again as even more distant whale hunting locations, especially in the North and South Pacific, became increasingly attractive. Whales migrated thousands of miles between breeding areas and feeding grounds, and a location known as the offshore ground west of the Galapagos Islands became a popular destination for hunters. Generally, whale hunting spanned about 15 regions within an enormous, roughly triangular oceanic area defined by southerly points near Cape Horn and New Zealand, and extending as far north as the Arctic Ocean. On a typical voyage to the Pacific Ocean, a vessel would set sail from a port such as New Bedford in the early summer months to have time to navigate around Cape Horn and be able to pursue whales in the South Pacific in December and January. Then it might sail north via the Marquesas Islands in French Polynesia and the Marshall Islands, loop around the North Pacific, including the coast of Japan, the west coast of America and Hawaii, and return to the South Pacific in November. Alternatively, it might sail directly to hunt in the North Pacific, using Hawaii as a stopping point before turning south again. If a vessel was late leaving New Bedford in the summer, it would instead cross the Atlantic and sail around the Cape of Good Hope to align with seasonal migration patterns arriving in the South Pacific by March. About a quarter of voyages went this route instead of around Cape Horn. Either way, the journey was long and treacherous. By the 1850s, the average American whaling voyage took 3.6 years. Whalers went in pursuit of lucrative sperm oil, and whalebone. The product of a whale depended largely on the type of whale being hunted. Sperm oil came from the head, or case, of the sperm whale and was the highest quality oil, used for both illumination and lubrication. It was taken in solid and liquid form. The solid form, spermaceti, was used for candles, while the liquid form was used for lubricating fine machinery, particularly in the textile industry, and in applications that were exposed to a wide range of temperatures. Whale oil was rendered from the blubber of sperm, right, bowhead, and occasionally humpback whales. While it was widely viewed as inferior to sperm oil, whale oil was also sometimes used for lighting and lubricating heavy machinery. Whalebone, which is not actually bone but the baleen from the upper jaws of filter-feeding right, bowhead, and humpback whales, was used in applications that required plasticity. Once heated, it could be reshaped, and after it cooled, it would retain its new shape while also remaining somewhat flexible, a feature valued by makers of various consumer goods. The potential value of a whale was large. The average sperm whale yielded approximately 25 barrels of sperm oil, 787.5 gallons, and the average right or bowhead 60 barrels of whale oil, 1,890 gallons. The largest sperm whales, however, could contain 85 barrels of sperm oil. The largest bowheads could yield 275 barrels of oil and 3,500 pounds of whalebone. In aggregate, the growing U.S. whaling industry became financially significant, especially to the economy of New England. In 1845, U.S. production reached a level of 525,000 barrels of whale and sperm oil. In 1854, whalers received net income of $10.8 million, the largest amount recorded in a single year, over $300 million in today's money. In each year from 1853 to 1857, the total whaling haul sold for about 50% of the capital value of the entire whaling fleet. In other words, the return on assets in whaling ventures could be high. For captains of voyages, tremendous income and wealth gains were possible. Although few voyages in the 19th century returned with more than $100,000, about $3 million today, worth of product, accounts of the occasional outsized successes were used to motivate captains and crew. In 1830, the Loper completed what the Nantucket Inquirer hailed as the greatest voyage ever made. Operated mostly by a black crew, the Loper returned to port with 2,280 barrels of sperm oil from a short 14 and a half months at sea. When the Benjamin Tucker returned to New Bedford in 1851, it held 73,707 gallons of whale oil, 5,348 gallons of sperm oil, and 30,012 pounds of whalebone, yielding a net profit of $45,320. The whale ship Favorite set sail from Fairhaven, Massachusetts in 1850, returning 3 years later with a catch valued at $116,000. The New Bedford whale ship Montreal was acclaimed in 1853 for its $136,023 catch from a voyage also lasting close to 3 years. Starbuck annotates the 1864 voyage of the Pioneer, captained by Ebenezer Morgan, with the words, "Made best voyage on record. Its cargo was worth $150,000. The long-tail distribution of payoffs meant accepting that a voyage could return full or empty and that individual outcomes would be too difficult to determine in advance. Ships commonly returned to port without a sufficient load to compensate a captain and crew for their multi-year efforts. According to Starbuck, the whale ship Emmeline set sail in July 1841, bringing back just 10 barrels of oil 26 months later. A year into that voyage, in July 1842, the Emmeline's captain had been killed by a whale. Of the 68 whale ships returning to the ports of New Bedford and Fairhaven in 1858, Starbuck states that 44, or almost two-thirds, were unprofitable. While a voyage that made a negligible profit was labeled as a saving voyage, a loss-making voyage was termed a broken voyage. Moral opprobrium was heaped on captains who returned with less than full cargoes of oil, and the career concerns and reputational risks from doing so were substantial. Leonard Gifford, captain of the Hope, who set sail from New Bedford in April 1851, wrote to his fiancée in 1853, "If I live to reach home, no man shall be able to say by me, 'There goes a fellow that brought home a broken voyage.'" A broken whaling voyage meant crews would be reluctant to sign on for a captain's next voyage, so it was tantamount to industry expulsion. Knowing this, Gifford extended his voyage another 3.5 years in search of whale oil. The Hope returned to port in 1857 after hunting in the Pacific Ocean. Starbuck documents that it had 965 barrels of sperm oil at that time and 30 barrels of whale oil, and that the Hope had sent home 1,235 barrels of sperm oil on another ship during the voyage. Gifford married his fiancée 2 weeks after his return to New Bedford. A broken voyage as a whale captain brought all the stigma of modern-day entrepreneurial failure. To avoid this indignity, captains engaged in dynamic decision-making as they attempted to maximize profits. In pursuit of extraordinary returns, they might choose to jeopardize a middling return or even risk total loss. During voyages, they sometimes decided, as Gifford did, to ship oil and bone back to New England ports from Hawaii or San Francisco to prolong a voyage and, they hoped, raise its profitability. The exemplar case of this strategy succeeding was on a voyage of the whale ship Nile, which set sail from New London, Connecticut in 1859, sending oil back regularly on surrogate ships and not returning to its home port until 11 years later. Because sperm oil and whale oil were kept separate and commanded very different prices, it was not uncommon for a captain to throw barrels overboard of the cheaper commodity to make room for the more valuable sperm oil. In 1871, the captain of the Myra dumped 100 barrels of whale oil overboard when he fell in with some sperm whales. Captains attempted to maximize the value of their haul throughout the period of the voyage. Yet, given the nature of seafaring risks, the left-hand sides of the distributions in figures 1.1 and 1.2, failure were an empirical reality. To give a sense of failure levels in the extreme, Davis, Gallman, and Glider note that 272 of the 787 whale ships, 34.6%, in the New Bedford fleet were lost at sea. Factoring in the multiple voyages undertaken by most ships, they estimate the probability that a voyage would not return to port on any one voyage at more than 6%. Weather was a major risk. Also, hunting for whales was self-evidently dangerous, involving as it did the capture and processing of the largest creatures in the ocean. When a whale or whale pod was spotted, silence was demanded. The crew knew to avoid galleying or spooking their prey. Once the whaleboat was within striking distance of the whale, the boat steerer, also known as the harpooner, would ship his oar, pick up the harpoon, set his knee in the notch cut into the forward thwart, and hurl the harpoon. Though in earlier times floats were attached to the lines, by the 1840s the iron harpoon head was fastened to a sturdy line and paid out from a tub in the bottom of the whaleboat. As the line passed around a post at the stern of the whaleboat and out over the bow, a crewman poured seawater over the line to keep it from catching fire due to the friction. Once the line had run out, the whale often pulled the whaleboat many miles. In the Arctic Ocean, right and bowhead whales had a tendency to head for icebergs, imperiling the whaleboat even before the whale returned to the surface. After the whale came back to the surface to breathe, the harpooner and boatheader would trade places. Once at the bow, the mate or captain would attempt to sever a vital artery or puncture the lungs or heart of the now exhausted whale. Whaling was a gruesome industry. Melville offers this account of a whale's end. His tormented body rolled not in brine but in blood, which bubbled and seethed for furlongs in their wake. When a whale was dead, the crew of the whaleboat set to the task of getting it back to the ship for processing. The whale may have pulled them many miles from the ship, making for a long row back. At the ship, the whale was secured to the starboard side, and a cutting-in platform was lowered into the water. Regardless of the species of whale, the head was separated from the rest of the body. After the head had been removed, a strip of blubber was cut from the whale, and a chain was passed through it. As the strip was winched up, the whale began to flip and the blanket strip was separated from the whale. When hauled onto the deck, the blanket strip was cut into smaller horse pieces, which were then minced horizontally into Bible leaves for storage. Large copper pots, the tryworks, designed to render blubber into oil, were set just aft of the foremast. At the whaling ground, the trypots would boil perpetually, the fire stoked by pieces of a whale's own skin. Once the oil had cooled, it was moved into the barrels that a cooper, that is a barrel maker, had assembled from the staves and hoops brought from port and stowed below decks. After the baleen had dried out and been cleaned of its hair-like filters, it too was stowed. This process of harpooning and handling a whale created significant risks for captains and crew, including death and life-threatening injury. In 1829, Captain Abner P. Norton of the Victory was killed by a whale when he became tangled in a tow line and was pulled overboard. In 1844, Captain John Cunningham of the Florida drowned. And in 1856, Captain John Fisher of the Bartholomew Gosnold was lost while fast to a whale. The risk of illness was high and treatment at sea or port was quite rudimentary. In 1838, Captain Benjamin Durfee of the Parachute died from smallpox, and in 1852, Captain Joseph Bailey of the Champion died of intestinal bleeding. Long voyage whaling involved stops ashore at least every 6 months for provisioning and to replace injured crewmen, but interactions with native populations in these places could also be perilous. Supply towns in Hawaii were especially violent places. Elsewhere, one account of a Pacific voyage by the Charles and Henry has a deserter being beaten to death by natives in Tahiti. Adding to the downside risk, voyages could also lead to insanity, insubordination, crew desertion, or discharge. Thomas B. Peabody, captain of the Morea, committed suicide by shooting himself in 1854. In 1857, Archibald Mellon, Jr., captain of the Junior, lost his life on Christmas Day off the coast of New Zealand when between 5 and 10 mutineers shot him and the third mate, beheaded both, and tossed them overboard. Flogging was a legal punishment for sailors on American whaling ships until 1850, and captains were known to administer lashes for even minor infractions to maintain discipline. Yet, perhaps surprisingly, even in spite of such risks, the number of deaths was relatively small in comparison to crew desertions and discharges. Out of 489 crewmen originally setting sail on 15 whaling voyages made by 8 different vessels between 1843 and 1862, only 16, 3.3%, were killed compared to 143, 29.2%, who deserted, and 166, 33.9%, who were discharged. It is no accident that effective captains were at a premium. They knew who was more likely to desert or be discharged, and in turn, agents knew the captains better than the capital providers did. Value accrued to domain expertise. It could be argued that a good whaling agent was central to success because he could raise capital, organize a voyage, and alleviate informational gaps. Organizational model, basic structure and ownership. 19th-century whaling ventures were financed in ways broadly similar to modern venture capital, as shown in Figure 1.3 of the online resources. The basic model of VC fundraising revolves around the intermediation of risk capital. Investors, as limited partners, supply capital into funds that have fixed lifetimes, and VCs then deploy this capital to portfolio companies. Limited partners, as capital providers, often face difficulties when attempting to invest directly in entrepreneurial startups because they lack both the infrastructure to undertake effective due diligence and the domain expertise to help portfolio firms develop complex new technologies. In whaling, capital was often provided by relatively wealthy individual investors, such as doctors and lawyers. Like their modern counterparts in VC limited partnerships, capital providers in whaling ventures had little incentive to invest in voyages directly. They had neither the knowledge of the best whaling grounds nor the connections to hire captains and organize crews. Instead, they passed their capital on to whaling agents who acted as intermediaries. Most whaling ventures were organized as partnerships, and equity in the voyages was closely held by a small number of capital providers. The organizational structures in Figure 1.3 reflect a particular mode of governance. As in all principal-agent relationships, the challenge in the whaling industry was to create a system featuring sufficient incentives for whaling agents to maximize the gains of the principals, that is, the owners as capital providers. Operating through agents created opportunities for efficient intermediation, and it also allowed for specialized human capital to develop. Like a general partner in a VC firm, the agent typically received a fee for his organizing services, plus a share of the voyage's profits. He could also be an equity holder. Moreover, captains and crews held stakes in their voyage's successes under a fractional payout mechanism known as the lay system, just as entrepreneurs in portfolio companies hold equity stakes in VC-backed firms, so they also have incentives to make sure they perform well. Their propensity for opportunistic behavior can be mitigated through ex ante due diligence on the part of VCs, by contract design such as staged financing, and by monitoring entrepreneurs post-investment. In theory, aligning the incentives of all parties in an organizational structure creates a collective incentive to maximize value. Similarly, a crew member on a whaling ship did not earn wages in the normal sense, but rather received a share of the net value of the voyage. This increased commitment further down the organizational hierarchy. Thus, even when most of the ownership of a voyage was in the hands of outside capital providers, the principle of shared ownership helped to reduce agency conflicts. Due to their overarching significance, each of these elements in the organization of whaling ventures, voyage financing, the role and performance of the agent and crew selection, and the lay system of incentives deserves exploration in more detail. Voyage financing. Financing needs for whaling ventures were extensive over the life cycle of a voyage. Ships had to be constructed or refitted and then provisioned for a multi-year journey. In the early years, whale ships and general merchant trading ships were substitutable, but as the industry developed, the need for specialized outfitting increased. Ships were designed with improved speed and stability to contest the maneuverability of sperm whales. Although the cost of a whale ship plus outfitting varied over time and by the type of ship, the industry became reliant on external financing for its capital needs. Davis, Gallman, and Gleiter report that the typical New Bedford whaling venture of the 1850s called for an investment of $20,000 to $30,000. For comparison, the average U.S. farm was worth $2,258 in 1850 and $3,251 in 1860, and the average capital stock of a manufacturing firm was valued at $4,335 in 1850 and $7,191 in 1860. By the mid-1840s, the U.S. industry as a whole consisted of 644 vessels displacing 200,484 tons and 17,594 crewmen, so the aggregate capital requirements were large. An 1858 consular report on the U.S. whaling system noted the intensity of financial requirements, stating that there is no branch of trade or enterprise entered into in the United States in which so large a capital is invested. It is a testament to the dynamics of capital markets at the time and to the widespread taste for entrepreneurial risk-taking that these ventures were ever financed. Of particular interest with respect to financing is the role played by banks. Banks do not typically engage in VC-style investing today, and likewise, banks were not the main conduit for the financing of whaling voyages. Banks can have multiple internal constituencies and revenue streams that distort how investments are selected. In a VC context, banks tend to prefer investing in startups that are likely to need standard loans in the future. That is, banks conditionally choose venture investments in early-stage firms that complement their existing business lines later on. But pursuing greater margins in existing businesses may not be consistent with maximizing unconditional returns. Furthermore, following theoretical work by Michael C. Jensen and William H. Meckling, if a whaling venture were funded through bank debt, the agent might increase risk to undesirable levels, knowing he stood to gain upside if a risky voyage paid off, but that the debt holder would be left to bear the negative consequences if the voyage went wrong. On the other hand, using equity financing would lead to dilution and induce wasteful expenditures by the agent, especially in a situation like a whaling voyage where monitoring was particularly costly. In theory, the optimal mix of debt and equity is at the point where the risk effect from debt financing and the disincentive effect from equity dilution are equal at the margin. 19th-century banks were not geared to deal with these types of complex incentive mechanisms. In New England in the 18th and 19th centuries, the relationship between banking and whaling was more interpersonal than formal. While the direct financing of voyages was limited, the intersection of banking and whaling networks created a powerful web of overlapping interests. Naomi Lamoureux shows that because capital markets were thin and information asymmetries between lenders and borrowers were significant during the early stages of industrialization, banks could effectively manage risk and mobilize funds to finance local economic development by engaging in business at an interpersonal and parochial level. Interrelationships of this sort can be observed in whaling. In New Bedford, for example, it was common for presidents and directors of banks also to be whaling agents, or at least closely tied to whaling families. And the link was often made from whaling to banking, not the reverse. By the late 1850s, New Bedford was home to a cluster of banks and insurance companies, some of which had been financed because of wealth made in whaling. Most notably, when Merchants Bank received a state charter in 1825, its capital stock of $150,000 made it the largest bank in Massachusetts outside the Boston area. The bank's founders, stockholders, and directors were leading New Bedford whaling entrepreneurs who also established the closely affiliated Merchants Insurance Company. The whole New Bedford economy essentially revolved around kinship ties and intergroup monitoring. Although it was not uncommon for financing to be provided from more distant geographic areas of the United States, including Pennsylvania, New Jersey, and even California, it was the local network structure of communities that generated financing systems favoring whaling. In New Bedford, familial ties were especially dense due to the town's Quaker roots. Quakers dominated the city's politics and wealth until at least the 1830s. While there is something paradoxical about the association of this peaceful faith, known for its rejection of violent confrontation, with the brutality of whale hunting, in some ways the fit between Quakerism and whaling was ideal. The religious outgroup viewed trust-based transactions as a comparative advantage leading to a high order of commercial probity and honor. Violations of social and cultural norms in such communities could bring severe reputational punishment. This likely induced honesty and loyalty in the behavior of agents and kept relationships from becoming contentious. Trust mattered because financing whaling ventures involved interacting with multiple constituencies. Since ordinary investors usually could not afford to supply all the capital required for voyages, and nor would they want to do so from a portfolio perspective, a system of shared ownership of whaling voyages soon emerged. According to Davis, Gallman, and Gleiter, it was common to divide the ownership of a vessel up into 32nds, 16ths, or 64ths. This meant that even persons of moderate means, further down the social ladder, might possess ownership stakes in a voyage ranging from perhaps 3 to 12.5%. While wealthy elites could frequently hold more equity in a voyage, financial diversification made sense given the variable distribution of voyage outcomes shown in figures 1.1 and 1.2. Despite his substantial wealth, which would have permitted him to finance several fleets by himself, Jonathan Bourne, a successful New Bedford merchant who became a full-time whaling agent and owner, managed his risks by investing in 46 separate whale ships. In some cases, ownership structure was quite complex. Over the course of 12 voyages from New Bedford during a period of about 25 years, the Amethyst had shares owned by 9 different groups, including the socially linked whaling agent families, the Howlands and the Wilcoxes. In other words, the risks were syndicated, and this facilitated the origination of large pools of risk capital. A syndication partner could also verify the potential attractiveness of the investment. As vessels grew in size and voyages grew in duration, more extensive partnerships for financing and control arose. Given the distributional characteristics of payoffs from voyages, some downside protection also became part of the financing structure. Venture capitalists use, among other things, financial instruments for this purpose. For example, preference shares financially subordinate entrepreneurs if a startup is liquidated by sale, merger, or acquisition. In the case of whaling, some level of downside protection could be gained through the insurance market. Both the vessel and the whale product were considered as insurable interests. Insurance underwriters, common in New Bedford and especially in Boston, charged about 2.5% per annum in normal times, since this allowed them to pay decent dividends to their investors. But the amount could go as high as 9% in riskier years, such as those affected by bad weather or war. Insurance costs also depended on factors such as the condition of the whale ship, the hunting area, and the length of the voyage. For a 4-year voyage, the average cost of insurance could be about 10% of the total value of the vessel and cost of outfitting it, plus the premium on the catch. A rigorous application of maritime law, including strict definitions of insurance upon outfits and catch, meant that owners were able to enforce their maritime insurance contracts. Approaches to insurance, however, tacitly admitted the risk-reward trade-off associated with whaling's highly uneven returns. Despite the non-trivial chance that a ship would not return to its home port, some owners decided to forego insurance altogether because the premiums required would cut too sharply into their net returns. There is anecdotal evidence of how costly it could be to fail to insure against whaling catastrophes. In 1871, the Howland family suffered $300,000 in uninsured losses as its vessels were subjected to the ravages of an Arctic ice storm. In 1876, the Howlands lost a further $817,000. Partial coverage offered some mitigation. Charles W. Morgan and Samuel Rodman, Jr., the owners of the whale ship Magnolia, took out an insurance policy with a value of $11,000 on its voyage to the Pacific Ocean and other places, far short of the replacement cost of a vessel valued at $20,000 that had been outfitted at the additional cost of $17,000. Starbuck records that the Magnolia set sail from New Bedford on January 1, 1831, and returned June 15, 1834, with a healthy 3,400 barrels of sperm oil. Insurance factored into the broader set of incentives used on whaling voyages. Because crew members were paid on the net value realized by a voyage, that is, minus the insurance cost, they basically subsidized the premium payment. Obviously, if a ship were lost at sea, only its owners back at the home port could collect on the insurance policy. Agents as intermediaries and their performance. Agents played a pivotal coordinating role in whaling ventures. They acted like venture capitalists as organizing and monitoring intermediaries. Not only were agents responsible for acquiring whale ships for expeditions, they also worked with captains to determine the necessary equipment and crew. They coordinated with owners to make decisions about insurance and advised captains on the types of whale to target and the geographic scope of the hunting grounds. Good insight into agent practices can be gained from the records of Charles W. Morgan, who was born into a Quaker family in Philadelphia and first became prominent in New Bedford when he joined the mercantile firm of William Roch Sr. and Samuel Rodman Sr. as a partner. He subsequently became an independent financier and organizer of whaling ventures. In 1834, he wrote to a captain that his whale ship, being now ready for sea, "As agent, I have to advise you that she is bound on a whaling voyage to the Pacific Ocean, that she is fitted for 30 months, and that we wish you to cruise for sperm whales for 20 to 24 months, and if not then full, fill up with whale oil. We leave to your judgment the cruising ground on the Pacific, though we would recommend the neighborhood of New Zealand, where both right and sperm whales are to be taken, and it would be well, especially toward the end of the voyage, to be where right whales could be taken." Agents used logbooks from prior voyages as a source of due diligence on hunting grounds. These were daily notes made by captains and first mates, providing detailed information on whale sightings, weather, locations, and crew morale. At a venture's end, the logbook became the property of the agent or owner, which acted as a repository of accumulated knowledge. Although whaling agents could entrust their captains with codebooks for confidential communication between captains sailing for similar, though not identical, partnerships, as a general rule, secrecy was of the utmost importance. "This book is given into your charge with a full understanding that all its contents will be kept by you in the strictest confidence," one captain was instructed, "and that you will make it a point of honor not to communicate any of its contents to anyone whatever directly or indirectly, or let anyone get them in any way except the captains of our ships." The monitoring function of the agent was also crucial beyond the domestic port. Agents had to coordinate with captains during whaling ventures to stage investments and ensure that credit was available overseas for such things as provisions to feed crews and replace equipment. All this took place at a time when global communications were quite rudimentary. Letters sent to and from distant ports on ships could take months to arrive, if indeed they arrived at all. Agents sought information from families of crew members who exchanged their own letters at distant ports. For example, the New Bedford whaling firm of Wilcox and Richmond wrote to Leonard Gifford's mother, sister, and fiancée when he was at the helm of the Hope. Messages were sometimes relayed from the most unusual places. Santa Maria, a small island in the Galapagos archipelago, became a mail hub because it was frequented by vessels hunting whales in the Pacific. Although the Post Office Act of 1792 had created a pathway to the growth of a geographically wide postal network, it was not until the middle of the 19th century that systematically arranged postal services existed between such distant places as New Bedford, San Francisco, and Honolulu. Whaling agents often had their own incentives to maximize the value of voyages because they held substantial ownership shares. Charles W. Morgan is recorded as having ownership stakes in at least 42 voyages between December 1823 and September 1856. For his eponymous whale ship, the Charles W. Morgan, launched in 1841, Starbuck documents 10 voyages between 1841 and 1877, mostly in the Pacific Ocean. Morgan is recorded as agent only for the first two voyages, after which the role passed to Edward M. Robinson in 1849, to the Howland family in 1853, and a few years after Morgan's death in 1861, to J. and W. R. Wing and Company in 1863. Morgan derived great wealth from whaling. In 1855, he ranked number 8 in the list of the wealthiest New Bedford taxpayers. General data on New Bedford wealth from tax records indicates that large fortunes could be systematically accumulated in whaling. During the early to mid-1850s, the population of New Bedford was just over 20,000 people. the taxable population, less than 3% of the total population, held wealth per capita at an extraordinary level of $34,965, or about $1 million today. The average wealth of whaling agents was almost double this amount, $63,725, and the most experienced agents accumulated substantially more. The average wealth of those New Bedford agents who had organized 20 or more voyages by 1856 stood at $112,642. Accordingly, the New Bedford Board of Trade commented in 1889 that, "Our wealth, our population, and our progress have been the fruits of this industry, and our position and fame among the cities of the world is due to its successful prosecution." Investment returns generated from whaling were reinvested in further voyages, perpetuating a cycle of wealth accumulation. The effect on the local economy was substantial. In 1853, the New York Times confidently asserted that New Bedford was probably the wealthiest place in America. Naturally, wealth accumulation for whaling agents was partly a function of the flow of returns from whaling voyages. Figure 1.4 available in the online resources plots the average profit rates across 1,566 voyages for the leading 29 agents in the Davis, Gallman, and Glider dataset. These top 29 agents were responsible for organizing at least 40 voyages each, so the returns were generated over lengthy time periods. Because agent fees are considered as costs in these calculations, the profit rates represent the average net of fee returns to voyages. For example, the figure shows that David R. Green & Company generated a negative profit rate over 33 voyages, while Gideon Allen & Son achieved an astonishing profit rate of 59.2% from the 64 voyages it acted as agent for from 1830 to 1887. Gideon Allen & Son's profit rate was 4.4 times higher than the average seen by competing firms in the same year. One whale ship that Gideon Allen & Son agented, the Millwood, amassed a catch valued at $172,841 and realized a profit in excess of 3,000% in a single six-month voyage in 1864. This exceeded the catch value of 98.5% of the voyages included in the aggregated data in Figure 1.4. Of the 1.5% of voyages that bettered $172,841, the shortest voyage to do so took 30 months, five times longer. The longest voyage to exceed the Millwood's catch value took a staggering 8.6 years. While Gideon Allen and Son generated a mean profit rate of 59.2%, the median profit rate was just 4.9%, showing the impact that an occasional huge hit could have on a long-tail portfolio's returns. To put this return into perspective, New York Stock Exchange stocks, for which comprehensive data are available, returned a compound annual return of 7.6% between 1830 and 1887. Gideon Allen and Son performed well under Gideon Allen's stewardship when his son, Gilbert Allen, was active in the firm during the 1850s and when Gilbert Allen took over the business fully after his father's death. One interpretation of this strong performance is serendipity. In fact, an 1851 listing of the Rich Men of Massachusetts describes Gideon Allen as being very lucky in the whaling business. This is analogous to the oft-cited modern VC refrain of, "I'd rather be lucky than smart," and the skill versus luck debate concerning the determinants of VC performance. Several other key performance characteristics are worth highlighting in the context of analogies with modern-day VC. The performance of whaling agents exhibited a high degree of persistence over time. Agents who outperformed 1 year were likely to outperform consistently. Agents excelled when they were able to recruit the right captains and crew and effectively manage voyages. Because of persistence in the returns, the best whaling agents could command a fee premium for their services. Fee income came in two forms: fees for organizing the voyage and fees for securing the sale of the whale product at the termination of the voyage. Davis, Gallman, and Glider report that for the Kaluo's voyage in the early 1870s, the agent, Tabor, Gordon & Company, was paid a 2.5% fee for outfitting and a 15% commission on the value of product sold. Gideon Allen & Son, unsurprisingly, charged a high fee compared to all other agents that had vessels returning to New Bedford in the same year. Finally, whaling agents earned compensation in the form of performance-based equity. Agents were typically co-owners in the voyages. Just as VCs take a share of a fund's profits as carried interest, whaling agents did well when a voyage returned with a strong catch. Agents often took large ownership shares because the route to wealth accumulation required being an agent as well as an owner. For whaling ventures organized as partnerships, the most common and lucrative organizational form, the agent's ownership share was about 39% on average, compared to 1% for voyages organized as corporations. Such personal investments by agents in whaling partnerships meant that incentives were effectively aligned. Agents shared more in downside risk by putting large shares of their own personal wealth at stake. Captain and crew selection and the lay system of incentives. Once a vessel had been secured by the agent, a captain was selected to undertake the voyage. While some captains sailed only once or twice from New Bedford, many sailed recurrently for the same agent. Indeed, the Davis-Gallman and Gleiter dataset shows almost 750 agent-captain combinations lasting more than two voyages. In a handful of instances, captains sailed on 15 or more voyages. Antone J. Mandley captained 20 voyages over his lifetime, logging a remarkable 40 years at sea as a whaling vessel captain. In whaling, past success had a sizable impact on the probability of future success, as is also the case in entrepreneurial performance in modern VC-backed enterprises. Before assuming command of a first ship, a captain would typically have served on at least three voyages, perhaps first as a cabin boy, then as a third or second mate, then as a first mate. Having such experience, the captain was expected to contribute to decisions about outfitting the whale ship, selecting a promising whaling ground, and sometimes even specifying the whale species to be pursued. Agents performed governance functions, helping to professionalize the voyage, especially for captains with more limited experience. They provided advice and encouragement. The well-respected agent Charles W. Morgan wrote to a young captain, George H. Dexter of the Condor, in 1834, "As you have now taken the responsible station of master of a ship and are a young man, you will permit me to offer some advice. The greatest difficulty I have observed with young masters is either too great indulgence or too great severity towards their crew. Discipline must be effectual, be administered with a steady hand, especially among sailors, and there is no station which requires more guard over the temper than that of a master of a ship. And on your first voyage depends in a great measure your future success in life. Let me then beg of you to keep a strict watch over the moral conduct of your crew. Never permit your authority to be abused or set at naught, but at the same time never to use undue severity yourself or permit it in your officers. I have a real confidence in you, and I trust you will not feel hurt at my giving advice which I feel it my duty to offer you." Much like a startup team, the agent and captain would recruit crew, filling approximately 30 positions on an average voyage, from first mate all the way down to cabin boy. Most whaling vessels carried three mates, although the number could be as low as one or as high as six. Each whaleboat needed a harpooner, or boat steerer, and most voyages carried four. Other vital crew members included a cooper, who assembled the barrels in which oil would be brought home, a carpenter to make general repairs, a cook to prepare what passed for meals on the long voyages, and a steward to serve them. Sometimes a blacksmith or other specialized tradesman was also hired on. The rest of the crew were seamen, ranging from unskilled green hands to men who had spent decades at sea. Crammed into the forward section of the whaler, the green hands and other crew lived in separate accommodation from the mates, boat steerers, cook, and stewards. The forecastle was dark and poorly ventilated, likely contributing to the turnover in crews over the course of months at sea. Incentive-based payments help to explain why captains and crew went through the pain and danger of these voyages. Fixed wages would have been ineffective in such settings because of information asymmetries between investors and crew and
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.